مجلس is has been sponsored for the إيصال الثواب of مرحوم كرمالي حسن علي راجاني. مرحوم كرمالي حسن علي راجاني. Please recite Surah Fatiha for the إيصال الثواب of the مرحوم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماءه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون الذي لا يدركه بعد الهمم ولا يناله غوص الفطن الذي ليس لصفته حد محدود ولا نعت موجود ولا وقت معدود ولا أجل ممدود فطر الخلائق بقدرته ونشر الرياح برحمته وودد بالصخور ميادان أرضه والصلاة والسلام والتحية والإكرام على خير خلقه ونور عرشه أفضل الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبا القاسم محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وفرقانه الحميد وهو أصدق القائلين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإذا قيل لهم تعالوا إلى ما أنزل الله وإلى الرسول قالوا حسبنا ما وجدنا عليه آباءنا أولو كان آباهم لا يعلمون شيئا ولا يهتدون صلوات الله. 104th ayah of Surah Mubarakah Maida. I have just recited in front of you an ayat of the Quran which is very much relevant to our time as it was relevant to the time of our A'imma alayhim as-salam. As a matter of fact, the challenges that Ahle Tashayyu are facing in the modern time are very much similar to the challenges that our Imam Ali al-Naqi salawatullah wa salamullah alayhi had faced. During our 10th Imam, there was a division within the Shiite community. There were heretic groups emerging from here and there. There were some people who were betraying the Imam from within. Never mind about the outside challenge or the external challenge that the oppressive and the unjust rulers of Banu Abbas were posing, but from within the Shiite community, the Imams had to face these challenges and had to tackle these challenges in such a way that the purpose for which A'imma alayhim as-salam were giving all these sacrifices had to be protected very meticulously. The Quran, the law in the Islamic concept is what? It's a Sharia. What is the Sharia based on? The Quran and the Sunnah. What are the ingredients of the Sharia? Quran and the Sunnah and Ijma' and reasoning, aql. Now here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this ayat, which I have just recited in front of you, ayat number 104 of Surah Maida, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when it is told to them, when they are being told, come towards Allah and towards His Messenger. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ تَعَالَوْا إِلَى مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ come towards what Allah has revealed and towards His Messenger. وَإِلَى الرَّسُولِ قَالُوا حَسْبُنَا مَا وَجَدْنَا عَلَيْهِ آبَاءَنَا. No, They denied, they falsified, they refused to come towards Allah and to His Messenger. And they contented themselves with this excuse. قَالُوا حَسْبُنَا مَا وَزَلْنَا عَلَيْهِ آبَاءَنَا. Sufficient is for us what our fathers or forefathers were practicing. مَا وَجَدْنَا عَلَيْهِ آبَاءَنَا أَوَلَوْ كَانَ آبَاءُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا وَلَا يَهْتَدُونَ. Even though the dear fathers and forefathers did not know anything and were not guided. Now normally on the internet when you log in to Taqleed and you log in to Marja'iyat or to Ulama, one of the ayahs that are being quoted by the opponent of ulama and the opponent of taqleed is this ayat. Now let us be honest with ourselves. Never mind about others. Never mind about others. Let us be honest with ourselves. See what the ayat is saying. And this is the only one sample of ayat. I have gone through all the ayahs of the Quran in which it is being said and it is being refuted. And it is being condemned, the attitude of the non-believers who say, sufficient is what our forefathers were used to believe and used to practice, and there is no need of going towards Allah and towards the revelation of Allah and towards the messengers or the prophets. Each and every ayat that I saw in the Quran in which taqleed of the forefathers is condemned is addressed to mushrikeen. It is addressed to kuffar. It is addressed to those who act according to their ahwa, to their desires. It is addressed to those who act according to their conjecture. It is not addressed to those who select for themselves the right source of following. It is not addressed to Muslims. Each and every ayat is addressed to the kuffar and mushrikeen. To mu'anideen, to the obstinate people, to the stubborn people who suffice in saying, no, we are not going to change. There is no need of following the Allah and the Messenger. We are going to follow what our forefathers used to follow, even be it the idol worship or worshipping other than Allah or committing kufr in open and committing shirk in open. So this was the excuse of kuffar and mushrikeen, not the excuse of muslimin and mu'mineen. But no, search for yourself on the internet. See what is being told. See how the general, simple-minded public and Muslims are being misguided. قَالُوا حَسْبُنَا مَا وَجَدْنَا عَلَيْهِ آبَاءَنَا أَوَلَوْ كَانَ آبَاءَكُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا وَلَا يَهْتَدُونَ. Even though that your fathers and forefathers did not know anything, did not have any knowledge, and they were not guided. But I ask you, what if their fathers and forefathers knew something, had knowledge of something, and were guided, and were on the right paths? So where is the excuse? Give me one ayat of the Quran whereby the Quran condemns following the fathers and forefathers and those people who are rightly guided and who have got right knowledge and who are hadi and who proclaim the knowledge that the Quran represents and the Sunnah of the Prophet represents. One ayat, only one ayat give me from the Quran, the whole of Quran, whereby the Quran is condemning those who follow the forefathers and forefathers who knew something, who had knowledge of something, who had knowledge of the Book of Allah, who had the knowledge of the Sunnah of Rasulullah, and who were following the right sources of Islam. Now here, one thing I have refuted. Now another thing is this. It is the same Quran who, when it speaks about the people of knowledge, the ulama, first of all, Quran, in order to follow Quran, you need to understand the Quran. In order to understand the Quran, you need to interpret the Quran in a proper way. In order to interpret the Quran, you need to refer to those who have the knowledge of the Quran. It is neither viable, nor logical, nor rational that somebody comes and follows an ignorant person. the taqleed or following ignorant person is haram. Haram it is. The taqleed of those who are not aware of the Quran and the Quranic message and the source of Islamic legislation is haram. The person must have knowledge and must have derived the knowledge from the correct source, not the incorrect source. Because we, the Shia Ithrashari of the Jafari school of thought, we do not believe that those people who lived with the Prophet, who were the contemporaries of the Prophet, who were the companions of the Prophet, were at equal level of knowledge. We don't believe this thing. And the history refutes it, and they themselves refute it. But they start from a premise that as-sahaba kulluhum adul, that all the companions are just. We say no, all the companions cannot be just. There are companions who cursed each other, who abused each other, who fought each other, who spilled the blood of each other. How can they all be on the same level? It's not rational. Therefore, we insist that whatever knowledge of religion and mazhab and the Islamic law that we are going to adopt is from the ma'sumin. Why? Because the Quran is ma'sum. The Quran is ma'sum, and anybody who wants to interpret the Quran has to be ma'sum. So isbat is a primary condition which we put in order to interpret the Quran, understand the Quran, follow the Quran. Likewise, it is the Sunnah of the Prophet. The second most important source of knowledge and source of law is what? Sunnah of the Prophet. Up to this extent that Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, salawatullah wa salamullahi alayh, says, "Man taraka sunnat al-Nabi muta'ammidan faqad kafar." Whoever abandons the Sunnah of the Prophet intentionally, purposely, he has become kafir. Therefore, who is to protect the Sunnah of the Prophet? The ma'soom source has to protect the Sunnah of the Prophet, because the Sunnah, because the Prophet himself is ma'soom. And therefore, in our mazhab, in Ja'fari mazhab, we strongly believe in silsila dhahabiyya, that when one imam says that I have heard it from another imam, he has heard it from his father, he's heard it from his grandfather, and in this way the silsila advances in such a way that the person says Imam Hussein says he has heard it from Imam Hassan, Imam Hassan says that he has heard it from Amir al-Mu'mineen has derived it from the Prophet, and Prophet has derived it from Allah through Jibreel alayhi salam. See the continuity, see the perpetuity, see the how the whole chain of narration is being guided and protected and safeguarded so that wrong knowledge does not reach us. And this is precisely what Imam Ali al-Naqi salawatullah wa salamullahi alayhi, did, that not only protecting the sources of Islamic law was sufficient, no. Preparing the people who are going to be the trustees of the knowledge of the Ma'sumin in such a way that it is in the time of Imam Ali al-Naqi that the deputyship was channelized, organized, streamlined in such a way that now the imams have got confidence that the people we have prepared to convey our message, to convey our knowledge, the knowledge of Ahlul Bayt, are such that they can be trusted. And therefore, when Imam alayhi salam used to send deputies, as a matter of fact, the four khulafas, the khulafas of Imam al-Zamana, ajallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif, were the trusted companions of the 10th Imam. They were molded, they were trained, they were given knowledge by the 10th Imam. Now they became qualified enough that at the time when the Ghaibat-e-Kubra is going to start, where the Ghaibat-e-Sughra is going to start in 260, these are the people who are to be trusted, and they will have direct communion with Imam Zamana. And in this way, now I have said one sentence I have explained. Let us look at our approach versus the approach of our brothers. The approach of our brothers, they say, yes, Sunnah Rasul has been conveyed until the demise of the Prophet in the 11th Hijri. We say, no. 11th Hijri, as a matter of fact, when you go and look at each and every hadith in Sahih al-Sitta, some of the ahadith do not have the isnad. The isnad breaks down in the middle, and the hadith itself becomes nonsensical, but still it is in the Sahih, and they believe it. We say that Imam alayhim as-salam has conveyed, first of all, in Sisila Dhahabiyya, which I just explained, and secondly, they prepared their deputies, and the deputies have to be such, deputies were such that Imam wrote, as a matter of fact, when he gave him the authority, when he gave them the authority, he wrote to his Shias that I am sending Fulan ibn Fulan. He is a trusted companion of mine. Whatever he conveys to you, consider it as coming from me. Look at the level of knowledge and level of confidence. Knowledge, we said, is very important. That whatever he conveys to you, consider it as it is from me. And whatever he denies you from, refrain from it. And that's why when we say that we are going to follow not jahil, not those who are erroneous, not those who committed sins, not those who contradicted themselves in deed and in action. And there are hundreds of examples to illustrate this particular point, that how they contradicted themselves. But look at the chain of imamat. There is not a single imam which contradicted another imam. And that's why whenever we quote the imam, quote any hadith of the imam, quote any tafsir of the imam, we gave the chain of narration. So much the Shia Isna'ashiris were particular about the chain of narration that huge volumes have been written about Ilm-e-Rijal. How are you going to know that this chain of narration is authentic or non-authentic? How are you going to know that who is the, for example, among the narrators, there might be somebody who came in Jamal and fought Amirul Mu'mineen, who came in Siffin and fought Amirul Mu'mineen. So how are we going to take, although they were the companions of the Prophet, they were a very close associates of the Prophet, but are we going to take them as reliable narrators? We can't take them as reliable narrators because they fought the very source of the Sharia, imamat. If you fight an imamat and you depend on the sunnah of the Prophet, on the imams, that the imams are going to explain to you, the imams are going to interpret to you, and then you come and fight them, we do not consider them as reliable. Even Umar Sa'ad, in Sahih, Umar Sa'ad is considered as a reliable narrator. Can you imagine this? Although he killed Hussein, but his ahadith are reliable. So those who kill Hussein is also good, and his killers are also good. And this is one of the reply that one of prominent Sunni alim is giving on the internet. And I have put it, as a matter of fact, on my Facebook, and you'll be able to see. That the Ummah, the in front of the world, this prominent alim of Ahl-Sunnah is confessing that Abu Huraira said, had it not been for this, had it not been for the fear that I'm going to lose my neck, I would have told truth about Muawiyah and about Ali. So this means one of the most prominent narrators of ahadith of the Prophet is confessing, and this Sunni alim is sitting and telling the world on the internet that Abu Huraira himself confessed that it was because of this that I concealed. So if you concealed the fazail of Amir al-Mu'mineen and you did not conceal the evil of Muawiyah, that means in how many more things you would have concocted things. So this is one of the questions, isn't it, that arise. Now, as regards the ulama who have got the proper knowledge and who need to be followed, the Quran is explicit. إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء. Look at the sanad. Look at the certification that the Quran is giving to the ulama, the rightful ulama, not those ulama who deny that we are not going to follow the what has been revealed through the Prophet or what has come from Allah, the first ayat with which I started my majlis. But these are the ones regarding whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا definitely يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءُ. Why there is a zabar on Allah, on the word harf jalalat on Allah, and why is there a pesh on ulama? This is the whole, this is the crux of the matter. Why is it? Because if this zabar is changed from its place and goes towards ulama, and the pesh changes its place and goes towards Allah, the whole meaning becomes upside down. But here this zabar on Allah says that the act is not coming from Allah, it is coming from the ulama. Ulama'u, they are the initiator of the act, and they are the subject, and Allah harf jalalat is a predicate. They are subject and harf jalalat is predicate. So the rightful ulama are those who are the ones among all the servants of Allah who fear Allah most. This is the correct explanation. Can you imagine? If Allah says that the rightful ulama are those who fear Allah most among all his creation, and then we say something else about the ulama. About the ulama. Then now, Allah is condemning following our forefathers blindly. Of course, Allah is condemning following our forefathers or anybody else blindly. But what sort of following? What sort of following? What sort of taqleed? What sort of taqleed? Let us put now dots on the words. What sort of taqleed? Taqleed which ayat number 104 of Surah Maidah says, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ تَعَالَوْا إِلَىٰ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ وَإِلَىٰ الرَّسُولِ. Taqleed of those who were invited to come towards what has been revealed in the form of holy books, in the form of revealed books by Allah. The source comes not from the Prophet himself, but from Allah, the source of legislation. The root of legislation is Allah, not the Prophet. إِلَىٰ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ وَإِلَىٰ الرَّسُولِ. And towards the messenger, because he is conveying on behalf of Allah. قالوا حسبنا ما وجدنا عليه آباءنا أولو كان آباءهم لا يعلمون شيئا ولا يهتدون. No, we are not going to come. Sufficient is for us. Suffice for us that what we have seen our forefathers doing, and we are following their footsteps, whether they were worshipping dead, or they were worshipping idols, or they were worshipping other gods than Allah, we are going to follow them. We are not going to change. أَوَلَوْ كَانَ أَبَاهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا وَلَا يَهْتَدُونَ. Even though the dear forefathers did not know anything, but what if their forefathers knew something? أَوَلَوْ كَانَ أَبَاهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا وَلَا يَهْتَدُونَ. And were totally misguided. They rejected guidance. But what if they accepted guidance? So now my challenge stands. Bring me one ayat of the Quran which says, don't follow your forefathers if they had knowledge. It's impossible. The Quran will contradict itself if it had said. Bring me one ayat of the Quran which says that don't follow your forefathers who were properly guided. There is no ayat of the Quran which says don't follow your forefathers. Let us take some very simple and simplified examples. I can see some children sitting with their elders here, with their fathers here. Now you tell me in all honesty, if you were to instruct these children, are they going to listen to you or to listen to their fathers? The first source of following for the child are their parents. That means the parents are maraja for their children. And the children are doing taqleed of their parents, isn't it? In everyday life, we see this with our own eyes. When the child goes to the school teacher is the marja. He follows the school teacher, and he does taqleed of the school teacher. When he grows up and goes to the university and specializes in any branch of knowledge, he becomes an engineer. his profession, for he has to follow his profession in order to give credibility to the knowledge he has acquired. The doctor, how many of us, when we go to our surgery and the doctor prescribes for us any medicine, we ask him, we tell him, we are not going to take these medicines until you show us what is the composition of this medicine. Why are you prescribing one tablet instead of others? How many of us? None. We just blindly follow. We do taqleed of the engineer. We do taqleed of the doctor. We do taqleed of the lawyers, and there are lawyers in this majlis sitting. How many lawyers, how many clients of yours have argued with you that no, we think that the advice that you are giving us is erroneous, and have given you the clause number and the clause number of the act which contradicts what you are saying? Nobody. So we neither contradict our lawyers, nor our engineers, nor our doctors, and we do blind taqlid. Yes, blind taqlid. We do blind taqlid. But when it comes to religion, everybody becomes mujtahid. Everyone wants to argue why this and why that. And such an unfortunate thing that they even misquote the Quran. This ayat of the Quran, you have seen now, I don't want to repeat it again and again, you have seen that it is directed towards the mushrikeen. And all the ayahs of this nature, of this tone, all of them are directed towards kuffar and mushrikeen, that don't go towards the misguidance in which your fathers and forefathers were indulged. No, come to the right path, come to the right guidance. Come to the knowledgeable people. Not only this, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says and certifies that only the knowledgeable people, the ulama, are the ones who fear Allah most. Now here we got sanad of the ulama from the Quran. And the Quran, when it says that understand the importance of law, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. And whoever does not judge or does not rule according to what Allah has revealed, they are the non-believers, they are kuffar. They are the kuffar. Therefore, now this ayat of the Quran, it is repeated three times. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. And they are the ones who are oppressors. They have oppressed not only the message of Allah, not only the message of Allah, they have oppressed themselves, they have oppressed the whole of humanity. So how can the Quran say that follow them? Those people who are oppressors are non-believers, and our fasiqeen are sinners, are transgressors. The Quran can never tell us to follow them. The Prophet can never tell us follow them. And this is what Imam Ali al-Naqi salawatullah wa salamullah alayhi. When there were certain people who purported to represent knowledge and to represent the Shariat and to represent the Islam, when they deviated, and in the time of Imam Ali, Imam Ali al-Naqi, there were deviations. There were Sufis who were coming up. So in the political side and in the social side, there were deviations. In the political side, the Abbasids were now breathing their last. It was a decline for the Abbasids. Increasingly, the Turks were becoming in power. They were the kingmakers. They are the ones who were deposing the caliphs. They were the ones who were appointing the caliphs. They were the ones who were putting them in prison. And they were the ones who were releasing the others of their opponents from the prison. The Turks were becoming very, very powerful. And there was a fear that the Abbasid kingdom or the Abbasid caliphate is going to be abolished at the hands of the Turks, because the Turks were imposing on the caliphs to act according to their will. Now here in this situation, because of this confusion, there were some Shias also who wanted to establish their marks on other Shias. So Imam Ali al-Naqi was praised by certain Shias who said that Ali al-Naqi is the awwal and he is the akhir and he is the zahir and he is the batin. People came and told the Imam Ali Naqi that your Shias are saying this thing. He said, "La'na Allah alayhim. May Allah's curse be upon them. I am the servant of Allah. How can I be awwal and akhir and zahir and batin? How can I be? These are the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what Imam Ali has taught us. This is what the Prophet has taught us. We are all servants of Allah." You see, look at the honesty, whereby they want to keep a distance between their status, although their status is very high among the makhluk. Yes, the knowledge of Khaliq is supermost. Nobody can reach that knowledge. But among all the makhluk, the creatures, their knowledge is supermost. If anybody was of a weak nature, he would say, yes, this is very good. Somebody is praising me and putting me at the level of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But no, not the aima of Ahlul Bayt. Not the aima of Ahlul Bayt. Imam Ali Naqi also warned against the Sufis. The Sufis who used to come and sing and used to dance and used to this, and the strange practices they have, which our brothers who put a blame of kufr and shirk on the Shias, but that they cannot see their own face in the mirror. This is unfortunate. They cannot see their own face in the mirror. All they are concerned about is to condemn the ziyarat as grave worship, and to condemn the practices of the Shias as coming as bid'ah. But this is not my subject. My subject is different. My subject is this, that we have to prove and we have to accept that certain taqleed is not only desirable but wajib. For example, as I've given you the examples of doctors, engineers and lawyers, you are doing their taqleed. Without that, there is no other way. You are doing, because you know that these people have worked hard in gaining specialization. There is a profession behind them. It is because of that seal of profession and the certificate that they carry, other people have got confidence in them. So whatever they will say and they will do is according to the specialist knowledge that they have obtained, isn't it? This is a matter of fact, isn't it? Now, likewise, in the Islamic legislation, when you are looking at the source of knowledge, Quran and Sunnah and Ijma and Aql, reasoning. Aql means reasoning here. What you are going to do is, first of all, you are going to vet the narrators. Who are they? Are they among those who were the enemies of Ahlul Bayt? If they are, reject him altogether. If they are from the friends of Ahlul Bayt, even the friends of Ahlul Bayt commit mistakes, isn't it? We are not mahsumin. We commit mistakes. So in this case, the role of the ilmul rijal starts, that which hadith is reliable, which hadith is not reliable, which hadith is mawthuq, which hadith is weak and should be rejected, and which hadith is mawdu', that it has been imposed, somebody has concocted it. Now for this, rijal al-kashi, rijal al-najashi, these are major works of the Shias that I'm mentioning, that they have taken each and every narrator and vetted their past and their policies and what they were and how did they Sayyid Abu Qasim al-Khuy wrote 25 volumes on ilm al-rijal. These are the people about whom we are saying that they sit in the corner. What do they know how the world is run? What do they know how the world is run, and do they know about the complexity of the world? Yes, anybody who produces 24 volumes of Ilm al-Rajal, may Allah grant this sort of life to everybody to sit in the corner and produce 24 volumes of Ilm al-Rajal. This is the contribution of ulama. From where has it come? It has come from the Ahlul Bayt, the guidance of Ahlul Bayt. The guidance of Ahlul Bayt. Therefore, Imam Ali al-Naqi has to show us a distinction. Who can be the friend of Ahlul Bayt and who is the enemy of Ahlul Bayt? Who can be the right interpreter of the Quran and of the Sunnah of the Prophet, and who are against the Quran and against the Sunnah of the Prophet? And this way, another challenge that Imam Ali al-Naqi is facing in his time is the ziyarat. Banu Abbas, in their oppression and zulm against the lovers of Ahlul Bayt, had proved to be worse than Banu Umayyah. Banu Umayyah killed them, shattered them, but these Banu Abbas now are not going to give them even a peace in their graves. How many times the grave of Imam Hussein, Marqat of Imam Hussein, Mutawakkil Mal'oon tried to destroy it. Salawat. During the time of Imam Ali al-Naqi itself, there came a time that the Shias were being taxed. Do you want to go for the ziyarat of Imam Hussein? On the one hand, Imam Ali al-Naqi had to counter the policies of Banu Abbas by giving emphasis on the fazilat of ziyarat of Imam Hussein. When Imam Ali al-Naqi was brought to Samarra, and Najaf was quite near to Samarra, he went and visited the grave of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Two ziyarats of Imam Ali al-Naqi are very famous. One is the ziyarat of Aghadir. One is ziyarat al-Jama' al-Kabir. You see, the whole philosophy of Imamat is portrayed in the ziyarat of Jama' al-Kabir. The whole philosophy of Imamat. In so beautiful way, the version of the ziyarat or the tone of the ziyarat flows that when you are able to see that this is the knowledge of Imam Ali al-Naqi, so much emphasis is being placed on the importance of ziyarat. That Imam, when he became ill, he sent one of his associates and he said, hire a person. Give him his ujrat, his wage. Let him go to the higher, the Rosa of Imam Hussein, and ask dua for me. Ask dua for a ma'soom Imam. Because he said, the dua in my grandfather's shrine is accepted. This is the importance of ziyarat. This is the importance of the status that A'imma alayhimus salam enjoy in the eyes of Allah and His Messenger. Therefore, how can we deviate from the path of A'imma alayhimus salam? Whatever they have told us, it has to be accepted. Unless, and also, as I said, that the deputyship or giving deputyship, representation to the knowledgeable companions of the Imam started from Imam Ali al-Naqi. And he was preparing the Shias that now the Ghaibat is near and you should be prepared now in my own presence. I am sending you my representative and I'm giving them authority. In as much as Allah is giving authority to Rasulullah, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Whatever my messenger has given you, take it, adopt it. And from whatever he has refrained, you stop from it. So that means that Quran is giving complete authority to Rasulullah. That means that if in the matter of religion, if you want to follow somebody, then it is blind taqlid. Yes, blind taqlid of Rasulullah. Because Allah is saying, وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. And not only this, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهُ. Whoever follows the messenger, it is as if he has followed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the amount of authority. And it is exactly the same authority that the Quran has given to Rasulullah. Rasulullah has given to A'imma alayhimus salatu wa salam. And now if imams appoint somebody as their representative, then they have to be followed because Imam Ja'far is Sadiq salawatullah wa salamullah alayhi. Says that our representatives represent us, follow them because and take their command as if the command is emanating from the Imam himself. Therefore, where is the scope of challenging them? Where is the scope of challenging them? There is no scope of challenging them. If we want to follow the correct religion, then in the matter of religion, we have to recognize that there are knowledgeable people that are more eligible than them, and anything that is going to bring them down is the decline in their knowledge. Anything that is going to elevate them is the increase in their knowledge, isn't it? The knowledge is going to be the criteria, isn't it? Nothing else can be the criteria. No riches can be the criteria. No power can be the criteria. It is the knowledge that they, and this is the basis on which the mazhab of Ahlul Bayt, the mazhab of Isna Ashris, is based. And it has been based and molded in such a way. Now when it comes to ziyarat, somebody comes to Imam Ali al-Naqi and says, Ya Mawla, there is one companion of yours who has become so disabled. He wants to go to the ziyarat of your grandfather, but he cannot go. So Imam ko pucha, Imam ne pucha, ke kya hua? Imam se kaha gaya, ke ye un mein se hai, ke jo ziyarat Hussain karne ke liye ja raha tha, aur hukm-e-shahi aayi, کہ جو بھی زیارت حسین کرنے کے لیے جائے اس کا ایک ہاتھ کاٹا جائے پھر بھی دوسرے سال وہ زیارت حسین کے لیے گیا تو حکم آیا کہ دوسرا ہاتھ کاٹا گیا پھر تیسرے سال وہ زیارت کے لیے گیا رکا نہیں زیارت کے لیے گیا پھر حکم آیا کہ ایک بار پیر کاٹا جائے اس نے ایک پیر کی قربانی دی چوتھے سال بھی اس نے اصرار کیا کہ مجھے زیارت کرنی ہے اور زیارت کے لیے آیا چوتھا اس کا دوسرا پیر بھی کاٹا گیا اب وہ بالکل اپاج ہو گیا ہے نہ چل سکتا ہے نہ کچھ کر سکتا ہے امام زار و قطار روئے اس کی حالت سن کر زار و قطار روئے کہا مجھے لے چلو اس کے پاس امام علی النقی کو لایا گیا امام علی النقی نے خود اپنے ہاتھوں سے اسے اٹھایا اور اونٹ پر بٹھایا اور خود لے گئے اس کو زیارت حسین کے لیے یہ مرتبہ زوار حسین کا یہ مرتبہ ہے کہ ایک معصوم خود اٹھا کر ایک ادنا غلام کو اٹھا کر زیارت حسین کے لیے لے جائے یہ مرتبہ زیارت حسین کا آپ ذرا سوچیں کہ کس طرح جو لوگ حسین کی زیارت کے مشتاق ہیں حسین ان کو اپنی زیارت سے مشرف کرتے ہیں کبھی کبھی آپ کو حسین کی زیارت کے لیے جانے کی ضرورت بھی نہیں ہے خود حسین آپ کی زیارت کو آتے ہیں خود حسین آپ کی زیارت کو آتے ہیں آپ پوچھیں گے یہ کس طرح ہو سکتا ہے کہ خود حسین آپ کی زیارت کے آئے ہیں میں آپ کو تاریخ سے ہی واقعہ دے رہا ہوں کہ کس طرح حسین باعث فخر سمجھتے ہیں کہ اپنے چاہنے والوں کی زیارت کے لیے آئے یہاں پر جبکہ کوفہ سے شام کے راستے میں ایک جگہ آئی کہ جہاں پر کرسچن رہا کرتے تھے مسیحی رہا کرتے تھے تو شمر آیا اور مسیحیوں کے دیر میں اس نے دستک کی تو کوئی بڑھا پادری نکلا شمر نے اسے کہا کہ دیکھو ہم مسافر ہیں اور ہمیں جگہ دی جائے ہمیں آسرا دیا جائے شمر سے پوچھا کہ کون ہیں یہ لوگ کہ جو اسیر ہیں یہ سر کن کے ہیں تو کہا ایک باغی نے بغاوت کی ہے ہمارے امیر المومنین کے خلاف اور یزید نے ان کو قتل کیا یزید کی فوج نے ان کو قتل کیا اور ان کے بچوں کو ان کی عورتوں کو اسیر کیا لہذا ہم چاہتے ہیں تم ہمیں سہارا دو کہا دیکھو ہمارے دیر میں تمہارے لیے تو کوئی جگہ نہیں ہے تم باہر ہی رہو لیکن ان اسیروں کو ان سروں کو ہم اپنے دیر میں جگہ دے سکتے ہیں اپنے گرجوارے میں یا اپنے چرچ میں جگہ دے سکتے ہیں اب جب یہ اسیروں کا قافلہ اندر آیا کرسچنوں کے دیر میں آیا اور یہ سر سب آئے تو ایک ہی سر تھا کہ جو ایک صندوق میں بند تھا وہ صندوق لایا گیا دیر میں اور کرسچن دیکھ رہا ہے پادری دیکھ رہا ہے کہ جس حجرے میں یہ سر رکھا ہوا تھا یہ صندوق رکھا ہوا تھا وہاں وہاں سے نور کے شعلے نکلتے تھے پورے اجرے میں پھیل جاتے تھے یہی نہیں اس نے دیکھا کہ اس سر سے ایک نور کا شعلہ جو نکلا آسمان کی جانب بلند ہوا یہ متحیر ہوا یہ کیا بات ہے یہ معمولی آدمی تو نہیں ہے یہ کوئی غیر معمولی آدمی ہے جبکہ اس نے یہ کرامت اپنی آنکھوں سے دیکھی تو اس کو قبول کرنا پڑا کہ شاید یہ بنو آدم کے سردار ہیں شاید یہ وہ لوگ ہیں کہ جن کا تذکرہ تورات میں بھی ہوا ہے انجیل میں بھی ہوا ہے اتنے میں پادری نے دیکھا کہ ایک آم ماری اتری آسمان سے اس میں چند بیبیاں تھیں جی بیبیاں کے بیبیوں کے حلقے میں ایک معظمہ تھی وہ معظمہ اس سر کے پاس آئی اور اس معظمہ نے سلام کیا السلام علیک یا مظلوم الام السلام علیک یا غریب الام السلام علیک یا شہید الام جب صدیق طاہرہ نے سلام کر دیا اب یہ پادری گھبرایا کہ یہ کیا غیر معمولی باتیں ہو رہی ہیں اتنے میں اس کو غش آ گیا وہ گر پڑا غش سے جب اس کی آنکھ کھلی تو اس نے صدائیں سنی ایک معظمہ کی آوازیں سنی وہ معظمہ کہہ رہی تھی میرے لال تجھے کس نے قتل کیا میرے لال تیرا سر تن سجدہ کس نے کیا میرے لال تیرے بچوں کو کس نے یتیم کیا میرے لال تیرے بیویوں کو کس نے اسیر کیا اب یہ اتنا گھبرایا جب آوازیں رک گئیں تو وہ سر کے پاس آیا کہا تمہیں واسطہ دے رہا ہوں اللہ کا مجھے بتاؤ تم کون ہو مجھے بتاؤ تم کون ہو آواز آئی اے شخص تو میرا حسب نسب جاننا چاہتا ہے تو دیکھو انا ابن محمد المصطفی انا ابن علی المرتضی انا ابن فاطمہ الزہرا انا ابن خدیجۃ الکبریٰ میں وہ ہوں جس کو بے خطا پیاسا قتل کیا گیا میں شہید کربلا ہوں میں مظلوم کربلا ہوں میں مظلوم نینوا ہوں میں وہ ہوں جس کی شہادت پر آسمان رویا زمین روئی انا للہ و انا الیہ راجعون وسيعلم الذین ظلموا ایام انقلب ينقلبون اللهم اغفر للمؤمنین والمؤمنات والمسلمین والمسلمات الاحیاء منهم والاموات وتابع بيننا وبينهم الخيرات انك مجيب الدعوات انك قاضي الحاجات انك على كل شيء قدير ما تبع حسين